This is another point of clarification. And of course, I could make so many points of clarification, like so many footnotes scattered around the place. But the same problem exists, as did when I was writing my PhD, which is that all number of footnotes are insufficient to correct a fundamental error of misperception or misunderstanding of one's true orientation, one's true meaning. You can't correct the smaller points and then expect people to somehow draw the big picture from that. And it remains a real problem with the current Western paradigm, the way that everybody thinks the ideal situation and the correct one and the unquestionable one is that we all now need to return to nature, return to however we conceptualize our human natures to be. And I couldn't, in most respects, for the large part, I couldn't disagree more. I really don't think that's advisable, nor is it really that coherent to wish to return to nature or become what one supposedly is in the sort of archetypal or fundamental essential sense, because these essences, they really don't exist at all. Humans create the idea of an essence in a manner that is always retrospective, and it's a way of oversimplifying and summing up, and then the oversimplification gets entrenched as truth, and then when it does that, it's entrenched as truth, it replicates itself because people come to believe this is my essence. This is my feminine essence. And if you believe that long enough, you hypnotize yourself. And humans are very, very susceptible to all sorts of levels of hypnotization. That's why the advertising industry works. That's why narcissists get inside your head. I think in contemporary life, we still underestimate the power of hypnotism and self-hypnotism. But when it comes to gender, it's usually something very close to what we're doing. We're actually persuading ourselves that we have a particular essence and that we can align with it and somehow refine ourselves on the basis of it. And, generally speaking, no. It's an idea. So some people, it's a very useful idea to align themselves with certain characteristics pertaining to their gender. And to other people, it's a very, very difficult, unpleasant, or impossible idea. But in any case, it's an idea. It's not essence. It's not truth. It's not core reality. It's not the real nature of our beings. And so we can't actually try to become something that's just really an idea. An idea that humans have invented and has become historically tangible and historically salient and culturally manifest. So try. I mean, try in my futile manner, try in the manner that perhaps I'm doomed to fail in, because you've got to kind of snap into understanding my position somehow, in some manner, take a leap and get into a different orientation, and either you can or you can't, either you will or you won't. And my whole orientation toward gender is that it's not an essential, not a real thing. It's kind of a gravitation that some people have and some people have less of, to be a certain way, to gravitate toward a couple of reproductive polarities. But then consider me, I don't like the concept of reproduction, don't like that at all, never liked that at all. So I really can't be defined by my reproductive role in the human race. You can try and shoehorn me into that identity and say that's your real nature. But my experience testifies otherwise, and my emotions testify otherwise. So you've got a lot of hard work to do if you're going to be particularly oppressive in that manner, especially at my age, because I've learned so well that certain things simply do not fit me. And, well, that said, what have I been trying to do of late that is not quite the same, or in fact absolutely different from trying to get in touch with my nurturing self, or to get into a mode of or capacity of self-nurturing? What have I been doing instead? I'll briefly explain it. But you have to be kind of from my era. Do you remember way back in the 70s when we had those little LPs and those little discs that we would spin the records on, and sometimes the record would get something unpleasant on it, some grime, some grease, some dust, and the needle would skip, it would jump to another track, and or it might just stop there and keep repeating the same line over and over and over again. Really annoying, like a stuck record, and you basically had to clean it, or if it had scratches, then that was pretty screwed up. You couldn't play that record. So if we understand that analogy, or if you don't, then try to imagine it. Then what I have been trying to do is to confront the aspects of my mind and of my past and of my existence that have formed the little scratches and the dust and the grime on the flat plate of my LP, my record, long playing record. And what I've been trying to do is eliminate those scratches and those lumps and that dust so that the record will play more smoothly. So what I've been trying to do is come to terms with what has been in effect in many aspects quite significant generational trauma that was unpleasantly bestowed upon me, and also my own dust, my own scratches, and my own incoherent aspects. And it's incoherent because the emotion gets in the way, the trauma gets in the way. If you have a memory that is traumatized, it stops the record from playing. You jump to another track, and then it's incoherent. I confronted this difficulty in myself when I pushed myself to the limit in writing my PhD. I wanted to understand emotion through history, but I had the hardest time because the needle that reads the data on the record, so like my higher consciousness, kept jumping tracks, like trying to bring it back to the track, and it kept jumping again. And so I felt that, and it was in fact true that my story and my self-understanding was full of inconsistencies, kind of jumping around back and forth, trying to make sense, but with all these gaps, because the needle had been jumping in a way that it ought not to have been. It ought to have been in the same groove, but it was every time I tried to analyze or confront an emotional trauma, the needle jumped over it. I knew it was there, but I couldn't actually read it. I couldn't actually combine it with the rest of my life. And then I couldn't make sense of it. So what I've been doing is working to become comfortable with the most uncomfortable of emotions, with the most, disgusting in some ways, unpleasant and repulsive aspects that are difficult to come to terms with. And I've been trying to, and I have succeeded in melding them all back in to make them part of the whole story again, so that I'm not mystified, so that I'm not confused, so that I don't project all sorts of mysticisms out into the universe and say, it must be caused by this, something imaginary or that, or, you know, whatever it is you do when your thinking is wobbly and where your thinking is not embedded deeply in its true groove. So that's what I've been doing. It's been hard. It's been a training. It's been a discipline. It's been a painful process, but I've done that work. I've worked on doing that work for the past years, since I finished my PhD, since I noticed the issue of this particular tendency to not take in the most painful information, but to try to skip over it. That's what I've been working on. Now I understand all sorts of things better, of course. I'm not mystified. I'm not easily blindsided by anybody. People are clearer to me because I understand myself through the mirror effect. We have mirror cells in our heads, neurologically speaking. I understand myself. I can understand where the other person's record is skipping, where they're actually jumping over things and making a false sense of things that's actually not true to reality. So I fill in all the gaps. I become stronger mentally. I understand myself, but by understanding myself, I understand the world. And I'm less susceptible to abuse. So this is kind of like it's been a hard boot camp for me. It hasn't been easy.